we often forget as senior investigators that we're not going to live forever, and that while it's great to support young folks, you know, we really need to think about the trajectory of people's careers and think about how we're going to get the best people, the most committed people, to really continue to do the work after we all step down. And I think we need to talk about that more because we probably don't talk about it enough.
My name is Jyothi Mathad. I am an associate professor at Weill Cornell, and my grant is about HIV, TB, and gestational diabetes.
And my name is Kate Dupnik. I'm also an assistant professor at Weill Cornell Medicine, and my grant is looking at HIV, TB co-infection, and the HIV reservoir.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jose Martinez Navio, and I am a research assistant professor in the University of Miami Miller School of Medicine. I recently got an R01. And this R01 is basically, you know, HIV is transmitted mainly through mucosal tissue. And in this grant, what we are aiming is to enhance antibody translocation to those areas of interest and hopefully mediate enhanced protection against HIV.
My focus of research has always been on HIV-related and tuberculosis-related issues in pregnancy, and so NIAID seemed like a natural fit for that. And as we were training in fellowship, we were both part of like a training grant that was also through NIAID, and a lot of the networks that we're part of are all NIAID, so it just seemed like a natural fit for me to apply there.
NIAID aligns very well with my research, and this RFA was really perfect for this project, so I was really happy when I saw the RFA and I submitted the grant.
Yeah, NIAID has a very strong history of funding work in tuberculosis as well as HIV. And so there's a particular interest in co-infection. And so when it was time to look for funding, that's why I went to NIAID.
So the funding process for early career investigators at NIAID and actually at NIH as a whole can be incredibly challenging. And I know that many people submit grants at least twice. Sometimes the most dispiriting reactions you can get are when you submit a grant, you get a decent score, you think you've addressed the reviewer's comments, and you get the same score, or sometimes you get an even worse score. So figuring out, you know, what's going on there, really looking at the peer review process as it relates to people who are trying to get into the field. We should really be doing everything we can to try to help folks who want to do this.
One of the things that was really helpful for me with pursuing funding, and I think Jyothi, you did this too, was the early career reviewer process through the NIAID, so that I had a chance to kind of be a junior reviewer on a review committee and see what peer review actually was like, and that insight was really valuable.
The more money we allocate to career development awards, to early investigator awards, the more people we can fund, the more good science we could fund. Right now at NIAID, we are doing a review of our training budget across the Institute, and we'll be looking very carefully at how we can maximize those resources to make sure we fund as many really worthy candidates as possible.
During our CARE Awards, you and I both went to the NIH for a 2-day workshop on how to navigate the NIAID resources and grants and program officers, and it was an opportunity to present our science, meet other people who were in a similar position, maybe commiserate a little bit, and get tips for how to move forward.
Sometimes you can get the grant on the first try, but some others are a little bit, it takes a little bit longer, so you have to be persistent, that's the word.
I had a lot of mentors and friends and colleagues that looked at the comments and said, you know, it's not that they don't like you, they're judging the science, not you, and I think not taking it personally really helped. And then, you know, resubmitting and just keep trying until you get the grant.
You have to have a good idea. Like, you have to really come up with something that answers a question in the field. Then you really have to find like an RFA for which your grant is very well targeted.
When many of us started in HIV, it was about HIV the pathogen. How do you kill it? How do you treat it? How do you prevent it? How do you understand how it gets into cells? How do you understand how it causes chronic inflammation, and you name it? The field has now evolved to include much more than just HIV the pathogen, partly because people living with HIV are living longer, healthier lives, and they are necessarily being affected by many other conditions, whether that's things like long COVID, whether it's things like metabolic diseases, other sexually transmitted infections, you name it. That is a reality that we just have to understand. So if you're going to go into HIV right now, it's a very exciting time to sort of see how you can understand how HIV has the interplay with all of those other things.
I would say that it is a very long process, and also it is doesn't end. So just getting one grant isn't enough. You have to get the next one and the next one. And as your research grows and your research questions develop, then that naturally leads to the next level of funding.
I advise everyone to really speak with your program officer, your PO. It's really important. You may have questions as an early stage investigator, but they are there to help, and they are always super nice, knowledgeable, and helpful.
We need to be confident that our succession plan is robust and that we have well-trained, dedicated, really committed people to take over and move this field forward.